Welcome to the July 14th, 2000. Set? All right, try it again. Take two.
Yeah, you're right ahead of me there.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the July 14th, 2015 meeting of the Milton Conservation Commission. The commission is appointed by the Board of Selectmen to implement the rules and regulations of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act and Riversway Act and the Milton Town Bylaw governing the wetlands. As a matter of formality, two things. We always introduce ourselves and we have a record tape recorder running. So if you wish to speak, I'd ask that you identify yourself so the record will reflect that.
Judith Darrell Kemp.
My name is John Kiernan.
Michael Blut.
Alpha Doyle.
Kathy Bone.
First on the agenda is notice of intent at 0 Central Avenue. That's the town of Milton. They have made a written request that we continue the hearing until our August meeting, which is, what's the date, Judith? Judith, I'm sorry. You don't know, Kathy would know. I'm looking at Kathy.
11th.
11th. All right. Any comment? We can continue that until the 11th.
Yep.
Next on the agenda, number two, is request for determination of applicability. That's the DCR, the Blue Hill Ski Area Development. Anybody here from DCR?
Yes.
All right. Would you come forward, sir?
Full speed ahead. No, it's a good thing.
I think we all have them. Everybody all set?
Yeah. It was in the package.
Thanks. Could you introduce yourself for our record and tell us what we need to know?
Okay. Hi. My name is Jim Jackson. I'm a project manager at CDR McGuire, and we're working for the Massachusetts Department of...
The one you'd use the microphone.
This one here?
Yeah, you can pick it up.
Hi, my name is Jim Jackson. I'm a project manager for CDR McGuire, and we're representing the Massachusetts Department of Conservation and Recreation for a project that they're doing at the Blue Hills Reservation. The project is to construct a pump station to serve the Blue Hills ski area. They have a contractor who runs the ski area, and they're having problems with their snowmaking pumping system. They need a new one. And they also want to upgrade the water service so that they're tied into the Milton service. It's actually a little more economical for them, and we'll be able
instead of Canton?
In Canton, they're in now, yes. And it, to be more economical and be able to provide more water for them to continue their snowmaking systems.
Does that mean that this is, I'm just curious, I'm not sure it's environmentally significant, but do they pay then for the water from Milton as opposed to paying Canton?
They will be, yes. Right now, they buy all the water from Canton. With the new water connection into the Milton system, they'd be buying it from Milton, from the town of Milton Water Department.
Okay, thanks.
Yep. So essentially, we have a plan here. This parking lot is off of Route 138. It's the ski area parking lot. And the lodge didn't quite make it onto the plan, but the ski area lodge is right on the lower portion here. Right now, they have a building here that has the pumps in it, and the pumps are kind of outdated, so they'd like to replace them anyways. And then with that project, they actually want to build a new pump station, new water service, and it'll have a new electrical system, so it'll be a complete upgrade of the system. And this, what it is, it's about a 300 horsepower pump that provides the water, pushes it up the mountain for the snowmaking system, so it has to hit the snowmaking systems under high pressure to make the snow.
A lot of power.
Yeah, it's
isn't
a, yeah, it's a huge, yeah,
it?
It's a huge pump. Yeah, it's so the building is 19 feet by 29 feet, so it's about 550 square feet. It'll be right at the bottom of the slopes, kind of tucked into the wooded area a little bit. They didn't want to lose too much of the slope area, but we've identified the larger trees, and we're going to avoid any larger trees, but we will be cutting some of the smaller trees, you know, under 6-inch diameter.
Do you have those are my questions, actually, because I went through your notes today, and I had two. On G3, you get a note 19 about you're going to field, locate the pump station to save as many trees as you can.
Yes.
What do you mean you're going to field locate it? I mean, what we're looking at is a plan that shows where it's going.
Yeah, if we have to move it a foot or two either way, if a foot or two either way would save a tree, we would want to be able to do that.
All right.
Not hold rigidly to this plan, but, you know.
Okay, and then on C-03, there's a note that you're going to clear some trees, and I don't know if there's a survey that you've done. And second, there's another note that says the access road will include clearing. Can you tell us what trees will be removed for the access road?
Okay, the access road is just running along the slopes, and it's actually fairly accessible now. It's part of the ski slope area.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, so it's really not clearing. It's more leveling off and a little bit of grading. So it's generally a gravel area out there now, and it'll continue as a gravel area. There really won't be no tree clearing, maybe some grass and things, you know, just to put in the gravel.
Okay, and I appreciate and accept exactly what you just said. I'm concerned because these are the records coming in, and it sounds like this tree clearing. Can you give us a survey and just tell us the number and caliper of tree? You don't have to measure,
yep,
you know, 2-inch caliper, but if you've got something of substance, like above 6 inches or above 5 inches, tell us.
Yes, we could do that, yeah. Okay. Yeah, we could provide a list, yeah.
What it is, because there may be a way to avoid that, you know, moving the access road, or as you said, moving the footprint of the pump house a foot or two, you might be able to save some trees. That's what
we're going to try to do that. They did, you know, the ski area operator did want it kind of set into the edge of the wooded area. He didn't want to put it out in the middle of his ski area. They, you know, they set up the ski classes there. They need kind of that open area to do those things. They didn't want it right in the middle of that, you know.
But that's exactly why I'm asking the question. We
yes.
want a tree survey. You just redoubled
yep.
my concern.
Yeah.
Because if you push it into the woods
yep.
To save some other land, there might be a better alternative, at least from our perspective.
Yes, yeah, we can provide that. Yep.
Okay.
When do you anticipate doing this work?
They would like to, they're going to go out to bid next week. You know, so the bids will be coming in August. So any actual groundbreaking would probably be more towards like October, beginning of October.
But this fall.
Okay. Yeah, award it, you know, probably in September and then start working. The intent is to try to get it in online for the end of December for the snowmaking season. You know, they still have the other pump station that they could kind of nurse along if necessary, but they would like to have this up and running.
Well, how long would it take you to get a tree survey? When I'm talking about a survey, I'm just talking about what are you taking down?
Yep. Yeah, essentially we would go out and lay out the building and count the trees. We could have it by the end of the week.
And nope. Probably not just the building, but the space around the
yes,
building.
Yes, the roadways, yes. Yep.
Yeah, the whole, okay.
Yep.
Right, because if you need construction equipment coming in, I mean, we might lose a few more trees unless the contractor is careful.
Yep.
What I'm looking to, do we have any other site visits coming up? Because what I'd like to do is just take a look at, if you give us a tree survey and say you're only taking down 1 6-inch tree, we don't need to see it. But if you're taking down 15, you know, native birch trees or something, we'd want to know that.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd have some kind of a conditional approval. But if you could get it to us quickly, then we can go up and take a look at it, depending on what it says.
Yeah, so what you would want is maybe we'd set the corners of the building and the disturbed areas and put a ribbon on the trees that we feel would need to be removed.
That would be great.
Yeah. Yes, we could do that.
Do we have anything else for a site walk, Kathy?
Yeah, probably 5 Holcroft.
Okay. All right. Any this Saturday, next Saturday?
I'm not here either of those Saturdays.
Either
one.
What are our dates? Ingrid, I know, can't make the 22nd, but that's a Wednesday.
The next one is the 1st of August after these two coming up.
Okay, I can't make the 1st of August.
Okay.
Any other Saturday.
What's the next date after that? Because our next meeting is the 11th. I don't want to slow down your construction plan, though.
The
I don't
8th.
Want.
Thank you.
That would be the 8th.
The 8th. How about the 8th? Can you do that?
Probably.
Yeah. Yeah, I can.
All right,
yeah.
How about the 8th?
That'd
if we
good.
Could,
yep.
If we could meet up there, do you want to start at?
6.
It's 6 a.m.?
No.
Sorry.
No, yeah, at Hurlcroft?
No.
Okay. So if we start at Hurlcroft at 8 o'clock, we'd be at Gun Hill by 8:30, so we'd certainly be at the Blue Hills by 9 o'clock.
Okay, and I'd meet you there at 9 o'clock?
At 9 o'clock, is that okay?
Yes, that'd be great.
Okay. I didn't mean to cut you off, because no. you still have other information.
So that's August 8th?
Correct.
Okay.
And where would you like to meet? Right at the Parking lot or?
Yeah, right below it.
You want me to write the parking lot right below?
Yeah.
Yes, let's go.
Sounds good. I have some questions. You haven't talked at all about the wetlands, and I looked at the plan, and there's one area of, one of the sheets showed an area of wetland that was like hundreds of feet away. Also, but looking, before you switch the drawing?
Yep.
That drawing there, there's an elliptical or kind of an amorphous dash line, but there's no indication as to what that line indicates. And is that, I'm assuming that's not a wetland?
No, that's not a wetland. What that is that's an area where they did a little more detailed tree on our surveyors. We were out there, they look, you know, instead of just showing the limits of trees, they went in there and actually measured the size of some of the trees to give us some idea of where to locate the pump station. So it's just the limits of their more detailed tree survey.
Okay.
They tried to pick them.
Apropos of what you just asked, we had a, within the last, what, 3 or 4 months? 6 months, maybe. We had a replanting plan that was right along the highway, and there's a very thin strip of wetlands there.
Oh, yes, right.
It may be closer to the...
Closer to the Trailside Museum.
To the Trailside Museum.
Yeah.
But there is something very, very close to the street, which actually surprised me. You remember that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I do not.
I think it was in maybe the fall.
Yeah.
That DCR was in here, or it might have been the Trailside Museum came in here.
Well, they were in here because of the pond at the Trailside Museum.
Well, they were cleaning, yeah. They're dredging or cleaning.
But they were also planting trees.
But they were also planting. And there was a strip along the highway that...
That's further away.
Yeah, it's up north a little bit from here.
Okay.
Well, we do have some work a little north. We have... I'll go through on this plan, but then I will get to that area to the north a little bit. So we have the building. We'll have new electric service will run from the other side of 138. It'll run overhead across the parking lot and then be underground coming up to the pump station. So be, you know, overhead across and then underground coming up to the station. And then we have the base bid for the plans. We're going to have a 12-inch water line coming to this point, and then a 6-inch tying in across 138. Ideally, we would put a 12-inch that will run to the north, and I can show you that on the other plan, because the 6-inch has enough water to maintain their needs for now, but it doesn't really have any long-term growth for them. So they would like to get the 12-inch line going. The 6-inch is kind of borderline as far as meeting their needs as far as snowmaking.
Does a 300 horsepower pump, is that going to affect everyone on that line? When they turn that pump on, are we draining water off of every sub line?
They'll have to be careful. They'll have to keep it down somewhat on the 6-inch line. If they tie into the 12-inch line, there'd be no issue yet.
Well, that's a good question.
Mm.
You know, having to be careful doesn't help the homeowners in that area.
They'll have to keep it dialed back to it, you know. And they're getting approval from the water department to tie in, and they're going to definitely have some controls on that.
Yeah, that might be beyond our jurisdiction, but
it's definitely a concern, yes.
Yeah.
Can you talk about the erosion control? Now, the plan shows that you're pretty much cutting in order to set this down, to set this into the hillside. Can you talk about erosion control on the uphill side? You can see all the grading.
Yeah, we're essentially not really cutting in. We're gonna you know, cut the trees, but we're gonna keep it at the somewhat higher grades, a little bit lower grades, but mainly the building's gonna be up on the back on this side here. Will be sticking out of the ground more. You know, kind of a if it had a basement, it'd be a walkout basement. But
it's a retaining wall.
The foundation will be retaining wall, yeah. So you'll see the back of the foundation, about 6 feet of it on the back.
6 feet?
Height, yeah.
On the downhill side?
Yeah, on the downhill side. You really won't see it because it's wooded, but it's going to be kind of out of the ground like that. Instead of going down deep where we would have difficulty getting access, you know, then we would have to put access around the back and we'd really be clearing a lot. We want to keep the access to the building will be on the already cleared side. On the front.
On the street side, can you go over that? You said you won't be able to see the 6 feet of foundation because it's wooded.
Yeah, so this back, like the west side of the foundation, there will be a drop. If you were to walk from the slab level, it would drop down about 5 or 6 feet.
So where's the wood?
This area is all trees wooded here. So from the parking lot, you'll just see the trees. You won't see the back of this building.
All right, so it really is in the, I'm sorry. I thought it was further towards the existing ski house.
No, it's
where it was older.
Yeah, this is all wooded here.
Oh, okay. Oh, you definitely need a sidewalk.
Yeah, we do.
Okay. All right.
Because I can't quite picture it. Is it near the bunny slope? You know where the bunny slope comes down?
That's pretty open.
That's wide open, though. There are trees.
That's where I thought it was.
Yeah, it's wide open going up, but there is, between the parking lot and the trail, is it's a pretty good strip, but, you know, a good 100 feet of trees, wide tree area.
Left hand side.
Yeah.
So there's a road going through there and the footprint of the building.
The road is going to stay up in the already cleared area, like the bunny slope area where the ski area.
Okay. Yeah. And where are you measuring from for our jurisdiction? Can you just point out the wetlands?
Yeah, for wetlands, we had... Okay, so this is a little smaller drawn, but here's the new pump station. Here's the ski area parking lot. Here's the museum parking down here. So we're going to be, we would like to, in an alternate to the bids, have a 12-inch water line that'll follow 138 along the parking lots and tie into a 16-inch water line in this area here beyond the museum building. And the wetland we were identifying as a pond here. And we had our surveyor, look for wetlands. He didn't see anything, in the pump house area, didn't find anything, and it sounds like...
Where's the trail sign?
Right there, right next to the right, left of the pond.
Yep.
It's a gray block.
Oh, that pond is the Trailside Museum.
Yes, yeah. So we will be running the new water line along the edge of the parking lot, in the paved area.
So is the building itself jurisdictional for us, or is it the... Is it that component of the project that's the water line?
We wanted to bring the whole project to you just to make sure there weren't any issues. DCR likes to be cautious.
Just at the end of the parking lot going towards the Trailside Museum, there's the native plants garden that's there as well. Are you aware of that? It's a pretty substantial garden.
They just planted it.
Yeah,
that's what
a year
I was
and a half ago.
Yeah. Okay, that's long ago.
Are you going near that area? I mean, how far
sounds
in
like
from
they're
the
going
street
right
are
through
you?
It.
We're in the parking, on the edge of the parking lot, on the street side.
On the street side.
Yeah.
Okay.
We're going to come in about 3 or 4 feet. So what we'll do is, we'll take out that part of the pavement and just repave it.
The portion that we're talking about doesn't have any parking lot. This is the portion between the trail side and the pond and the road. In 138. It's that whole zone is not parking. It's planted.
Yeah.
It's
planted.
Yeah. There's no pavement there.
Yeah, we're going to stay in the grassed area there, in that area. It's the grass.
We can walk it, right?
We need to walk it.
I don't think you can, Stanley, because that's where the garden is.
That's where the garden is, and it goes pretty much. Maybe I guess there might be a little bit of pavement, grass area, but not much. We need to look at that.
Okay, we'll look at it, and we'll mark it out, and we can look at it.
That's an important garden.
What is the pipe that you're planning on using for the run?
It's 12-inch ductile iron pipe.
It's plastic, or is it... steel? Or?
We're using ductile iron.
Ductile iron. Oh, yeah. Okay. Sorry, I didn't hear that. So there's not a lot of flexibility in it. It's pretty much a straight shot.
You can bend. You can bend a few degrees each section. If you really have to bend, you can put a connection on it. And bend it. But it's pretty much a straight shot.
It doesn't give it a straight shot. It's for you.
Yeah.
Potentially, it's through everything we don't want
to
go through.
Oh, if there was an issue, if there was something we had to avoid, we could put bends on it and go around it. We certainly could do that. Yeah. Right now, we're showing it pretty straight. And I've walked it. I didn't see the gardens, but we'll certainly look at that.
Yeah, it's right. There's the walkway up to the trail side. There's the parking lot, and then there's the walkway, and it's right next to the walkway, going towards the parking lot.
Okay, yeah, I'll look closely. We were out there mostly in the wintertime and didn't see too much. But
right now it's all in bloom. So.
All right, we'll definitely, if we are getting near that, we'll definitely do something to avoid that.
What's the distance from the footprint of the building to the pond?
We were looking from the water line, we were about 80 feet.
That, to the building they're proposing, that's hundreds of feet. You're talking
probably
300, right?
Yeah, 300 feet, maybe more, 400 or 500.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, the closest we were getting was with the water line work, which was about 80 feet.
Okay.
And the only wetland that you've seen is associated with the pond. There are no wetlands associated, as John had mentioned earlier, along the parking lot, between the parking lot and 138. None of that's...
Yeah, we didn't see anything when our surveyor and wetland biologist went out.
Do you remember? I know I just said 6 months ago, last fall. You might be right, maybe longer ago than that. But I thought they came up, I thought DCR came up with
planting.
Some isolated, they did come up with plantings, but I thought they had some isolated wetlands along 138.
Well, we have the drawings. We can.
Yeah. Can you, Kathy, can you just take a look
at that? Let's look at that, yeah.
Or bring it to the sidewalk.
Yeah, that'd be good. Yeah. Anything else, Mike?
No.
Arthur, any questions? Judith?
So August 8th.
Okay. Any questions from abutters, members of the public? Questions, comments, suggestions? Hearing none, and with the assent of the applicant, we'll continue this until August 8th at 9 a.m.
Okay.
On site.
All right, thank you. Right,
thank you very much.
Thank you.
Oh, just one comment on sheet 11. I found in the upper left-hand quadrant, there was some truncation of wording. Will you just take a look and see if there's anything that is critical to us?
Yes, yeah, I'll check that.
Thank you.
It shouldn't be. That's a structural drawing. It shouldn't really, but we'll check out. Sure.
What is it?
The viewport cut off all the text.
Oh,
okay.
All right.
Oh, yeah. Disappearing words.
Yes.
All right, Jim, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, next on the agenda is... Oh, sure. Did you want?
Sure.
Oh, okay. Thanks. You can
take
your time.
Swenson, 65 Green Street, Milton resident. Also on the board of the Friends of Blue Hills and the Bond Bill Coalition, the Blue Hills Bond Bill Coalition. I've had the opportunity to work with Vero, who's also here tonight. He runs the Blue Hills ski area. And because of my work with the Blue Hills and with the Bond Bill, we're excited about this new opportunity for the ski area, Blue Hill ski area. It'll be a wonderful win for the community, for all the wonderful recreational uses. And we are working diligently with Senator Joyce on the bond bill to support this effort, as well as many efforts in Blue Hills. And when you have a win for the Blue Hills ski area, you see another, trailside museum benefits and the observatory tower benefits, and where we're asking for so much money from the state, it always helps when there's local support for these initiatives. So these organizations are in support of this.
Okay, thank you very much.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Anybody else? Nope. Hearing anything from the Blue Hills, from the ski slope?
I apologize for getting that. I just got in from the airport. So.
All right, but you're in support.
Absolutely.
All right. All right.
All right.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks.
Next on the agenda, number 3, is Notice of Intent, 5 Hillcroft Road.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Thank you for coming.
Jamie Stillman, resident, 5 Hillcroft Road. And we're looking to add a deck to the back of our house, so it would be 12 feet deep, 16 feet in width.
Do you know how far it would be from, we've been actually recently on your property or next door. Was it 9? Ryan. And by the way, those bushes out front of your house, those are beautiful.
Which ones?
There's a lot. You've got roses, and you've got the
thank you.
Evergreens.
Thank you. We try. It's one of the first houses when you come into the neighborhood, so we try.
Absolutely. But do you know how far this is? I know it says 39 feet. Somewhere I saw 39 feet from, where did I see it? You've got a plan here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, last page, yeah.
And I think.
There are two different. You want this one?
Yeah, let me see. Cause I don't have it on the last page.
So
this one.
the surveyor didn't put the exact distance from where that corner will be from the edge of the water. That's something.
Right, that's right. That looks like a property line measurement.
It's a survey of the plot.
Right, but we just need to make sure. This looks like it's going to fit, you know, beautifully, so not to worry. But we've got this 25-foot non-disturbed zone mm-hmm. from the edge of the resource area, and I can't tell from this where the resource area is.
So which resource area would you be
questioning? Well, Gulliver's Creek, actually, that I know it kind of goes underneath. It actually goes under Squantum Street,
mm-hmm.
So you're close to it. You can probably eyeball it, because we've actually done a number of decks right down Hurlcroft Street.
Yeah, I mean,
we did one at 9 and one at 17. Or
the pictures don't give you exact distance, but I mean, there's quite a ways between that where that deck is. And there's an existing patio that's there that is much closer. There's a 23 by 13 foot or 12 foot deep patio that it's existing that's much closer to where
the
deck
is. The new deck is going over the old patio?
You can see the pictures.
The old patio is being removed.
No, patio's staying there.
Oh, it is.
The deck's closer to the street, closer to Hurlcroft
first
Street.
The house on the corner?
Yes. Yeah.
If I remember correctly, Gulliver's is on the far side of the garage, correct?
Correct.
So it's right behind your house.
So the garage is actually about 20 feet off of Gulliver's. So right. the distance is, it's quite a ways.
Okay. All right. I don't mean to sound like a stickler, but we have this 25-foot non-disturbance, and it appears to be you're well outside of it. But we just need some record that it is.
I mean, it's visual, coming out and seeing it.
That'll help. that will help. And I think if we could meet at your house at 8 o'clock on Saturday, the 8th of August, 8 a.m., and we'll be able to figure it out from there.
Yeah, because I'm looking at a Google map, and it looks like it's about 100 feet from the back of your property.
Yeah, I mean, it's quite a ways.
Yeah. Did your surveyor stake the edge of the wetland?
We did not.
We
did a strictly plot survey of the property.
Sure.
The wetland, it would
if you used
have to get a botanist in there, you said. The botanist would have to stake everything out. We're so far off, you'll see it, that I didn't think that would be necessary.
What's that?
He asked if the survey staked it out. I said, you know, we would have had to get a botanist, and, you know, it would have been a rush job to get it in here by everything. So,
right. We certainly know the area, and we've done this in the past where we can just, when I say eyeball it, I don't mean that we don't have a tape measure. We'll have
a tape measure.
But it's not like we need a surveyor crew out
I'll
there.
Supply the walking roller for you, the walking tape measure.
Really?
All right.
We should get one of those.
I know.
I have one if you want.
With our budget?
He's holding out on you.
All right. And what about the structure itself? What do you intend on dropping down? Are these pylons? Are these?
There'll be footings, standard footing sonotubes. They're going to go down until they hit solid, you know, whatever the building code requires.
Yeah.
You're probably looking at eight to 11 footings, I would imagine.
Yeah. There was a comment in there that I, not from conservation. It says that you will go down to solid material or the code requirements, but the way it's written implies that if you hit solid material before then, you're going to stop. But it depends on what you
That's
hit.
A contractor thing.
Oh, okay.
And I mean, the contractor wrote that proposal up.
Yeah. So. It's not really our purview, but it's written poorly. It's open to misinterpretation. Yeah, that's what I meant.
I can address that with him, with the contractor.
But it's not really our purview. That's the building department.
And the stairs that you're talking about leaving open and doing it at a later time, that's, if I'm correct from looking at this, that's on the Hillcroft Road side? So that would be further away from Gulliver's Creek. Okay.
When we were there last winter on your neighbor's back deck, there was a lot of wood piled up. It looked like cut wood in your yard that mm-hmm. we were noticing.
My brother's a landscaper, so.
Okay.
He drops off wood, we burn it.
You hadn't cut trees on your property?
No, anything that's been cleared, actually, no, there was one tree that we cut down when we first moved in, but anything that's been cleared was cleared before we moved in. We've been in the house for about 2.5 years now. There was one tree that was, and it was hollow. It was dead. It was just dead, and it was hanging on the house. So we had that cut down.
Just so that we're consistent, if you're altering that, you're in an ACEC.
That's an area of critical environmental concern.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which you know because it's in your application. But we try to make sure that people contact us because we get reports quite often. Say, hey, somebody's cutting down, and so Kathy has to go out and find out how come you cut it down without asking us. Maintenance is not an issue. Dead trees are sometimes public safety issues. So we're pretty user-friendly.
Yeah.
But if you see anything like that in the future, come to see us.
Okay.
Please.
There's a lot that's dead back there. I don't know if you guys just let it fall or what.
We can talk about it when we're there.
We can talk about that,
When we're there.
Okay, perfect.
All right, we'll have a chance to take
as
a look
long
at.
As it's not a safety issue, we like dead trees.
It creates a habitat.
There's more life in a dead tree than a living tree, so habitat.
How do you figure that? There's more life in a dead tree than in a living tree.
And that's true. Isn't that amazing?
Ask the tree
it's
that.
True.
Yeah.
It is true. There's more life in a dead tree than in a living tree.
Right.
There is.
Okay. All right. Now, so we've got a site walk set for 8 a.m. on Saturday, the 8th of August. But before we, are there any other questions from commissioners?
No.
Are there abutters, members of the public that have a question or a comment? Do you have anything else to add?
Unless there's anything else that you'd like to ask?
I don't think so. We'll see you on Saturday morning, the 8th of
Great.
August.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much.
Have a nice evening.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Next on the agenda is... next on the agenda is abbreviated notice of resource area delineation, 1383 Brush Hill Road. This is a continued hearing. Yeah. Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Andrew Hack.
Hey.
Just to meet face to face.
There you go.
Who's that guy?
So, Andrew Hack, Scott Goddard, professional wetland scientist, owner of Goddard Consulting. You guys have seen me before. And I was asked to give a sort of an independent review of the line. I know there was one area discrepancy after the site walk, so it was...
Independent.
Exactly.
Okay, all right.
Let's call it
You're a fair guy.
Okay. So Nicole Hayes from my office, she's a professional wetland scientist as well, and been doing it for 20 years, delineated the line. I know you guys walked it. There was one area of discrepancy between flags about 3 to 15, where there was one or two pink flags added as an area, like a little triangle, to kind of reevaluate and see if that was potentially more properly included within the BVW delineation. So that was left, as I understand, because I wasn't at that site walk, open question. So I was asked by Bob Hannigan to go out and take a look at it. I went out there by myself. I created a DEP data sheet, which was submitted to the board. And my findings were that I believe, looking at it sort of, and again, I know it's not completely independent, right, because we're with the same company, but I looked at it kind of fresh, with fresh eyes to say, if I was here, how would I have done this delineation as well? And I, in my opinion, what was done on the ground by Nicole was done properly, and I think the data sheets support that. So the vegetation in that triangle is kind of a mixed bag, right? It's about a 50-50 mix. There's some invasive stuff in there. There's some wetland stuff, but there's not an overwhelming dominance of kind of wetland stuff growing in there. It's a kind of a split environment. It's a very transitional zone. I did soil probes in that area as well. They came up fairly strong upland indicator soils throughout that area, and there were no other indicators of hydrology that would drive the criteria, because in the BVW delineation handbook and in the regulations, it's a bordering vegetated wetland where we have to have vegetation and supporting hydrology. So there's a kind of a two parameter approach in Massachusetts. Hydric soils is an indicator of hydrology, a very good one in fact, and other indicators can be considered as well. So once you get below the delineated wetland boundary where those blue flags are hung, the soils transition into a strong hydric soil condition. There's other topical staining of the leaves, puddling areas that you can see happens in the springtime. So I'm seeking that this commission support the delineation that's on the ground, and I believe it's backed up by the data sheets.
Okay. Cool question. So what you're saying is that without soil without delineation based on soils, it cannot be a bordering vegetated wetland.
What I'm saying is,
based on what you said, it needs to have both.
You need to have the wetland vegetation and an indicator of hydrology. Soils is one of the indicators of hydrology. Okay. You can have other indicators, but so you don't have to have the soils. It could be other indicators of hydrology, but it's one of the strongest indicators of hydrology that we have, right? So if you just have wetland plants and no indicators of hydrology, then you don't have a wetland. That was the pre-1995 approach under the 83 regulations. In 95, it switched to add hydrology as an indicator.
Okay. All right, now I took Latin in the eighth grade.
Excellent.
But I've forgotten almost everything I learned. And when I looked at the scientific names, can you help me with some of what you saw? Because in your letter, you're talking about your conclusion, the area was dominant in red maple, Norway maple, spice bush, burning bush, American bittersweet, poison ivy, New York fir, and Virginia creeper. But one of the concerns that we had when we were there, and you may have just answered this by saying that it's kind of a mix 50-50.
Sure.
But we did identify wetland plants there, and you didn't mention them.
So in the data sheet that you're looking at right here, it does list.
We saw the jewel reed.
Mm-hmm.
That was there, definitely. The cluster was there.
Sure.
You're saying you didn't see enough of it. You're saying percentage-wise, there wasn't enough of it?
Right. So are you guys familiar with how these percentages are calculated?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So you look at the, by layer, you look at the percent coverage from the sky within either a 30-foot zone or a 15-foot zone or a 5-foot zone in the case of herbaceous. And then you have to basically scale each layer up to 100 percentile. Anything that's a dominant is going to be defined as something that has a 20% dominance coverage within that zone. So you're going to have dominant coverage within the tree zone, the sapling zone, the climbing woody vine zone, the shrub zone, and the herbaceous layer zone. Anything that's 20% or over is automatically a dominant, right? So just because if you look at the herbaceous layer, there's a lot of herbaceous stuff. And this was a characterization, not of a data plot with a perfect circle. This is looking at the triangle of question, right? So you sort of skew the data plot to look at the areas in question, because really these data forms are meant for broad application of, is this area generally a wetland, and this area generally an upland, right? So, but when you start, threading the needle and looking at specific areas, it is appropriate and I think correct to look at a discrete zone. So I took that zone between flag 3, those pink data points, flag 15, and looked at that triangle. That's what this represents. That's why there's so many herbaceous stuff, because typically in the herbaceous layer, you're looking at a 5-foot zone. 5 foot's a very small zone. This was a bigger area, so that we have a lot more. So anyways, I took everything. You skew it up to the 100 percentile coverage, 20%, 20%, 20%, always get you in there. If you don't get there with the 20 percentiles, you have to have at least 50 cumulatively. So then you throw anything else that gets you in there until you get over a cumulative of 50%. So you need to have at least 20, 20, and then something else to get you over the 50 cumulative. So that's why this last category here, is the test of whether it counts as a dominant or not. So wherever you see the yeses, that meets the dominance threshold, meaning within that layer that's more prevalent than the other ones. Those are the ones you add up and see where you get the 50-50. Now you add it up and it's close, right? I mean, we have wetland indicator dominance of 5, non-wetland indicators of 4. So there's a slight more wetland dominant species in there.
That's
so I'm recognizing that, yes,
saw that.
It meets the, quote, 50% criteria for bordering vegetated wetlands, but short of having another indicator of hydrology, it doesn't really matter in a sense, right? So you can have, you've seen hillsides with poison ivy and things like that, right? That's a wetland indicator species, but there's no hydrology.
Right.
So you have to have hydrology and wetland plants. In this case, we do meet the letter of the law for having the presence of wetland plants in that area.
Mm-hmm.
We just don't have the supporting hydrology.
You didn't see any American elms there at all? I thought we saw some smaller ones.
You know what, there were some elms, but not in that triangle. They were just outside of the triangle, but there were elms there. And then when you got into the wetland, there were more. So we can look at this vegetation list all day long, but I'm conceding the fact there's a dominance of wetland vegetation in the area.
Right.
So we're there, right? You have it.
Yeah.
You meet the definition, but we just don't get there in terms of being a BVW, that's all. Because if you look at the soils data, it's primarily like a bright 4-4 subsoil in the B layer. So
and it lacks redoxymorphic features. So without the redox features or a higher matrix color, chroma, then we're just not there in terms of hydric soils. And there wasn't other signs of leaf staining, puddling, and things like that within that zone.
When you say redoxive features, you mean modeling?
Modeling.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Help me out here. What about plethora? Where is that?
That's sweet pepper, spice bush, and sweet pepper bush we saw.
Which one? Where are, I'm just going to find it.
Spice bush up top, the shrub layer, and also the ground cover.
Yep, so if it's greater than 3 feet tall, you throw it in the shrub layer.
Okay. And so what about jacket? I'm sorry.
No, I'm just going to say spice bush is a dominant.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, there was a fair bit of spice bush in there.
And we did see Jack in the Pulpit, but I don't know that we saw it in this triangle, John.
It was actually upland of this triangle.
Okay. It was. There was some sprigs of Jack in the Pulpit. Yep, kind of creeping around in there, but it was uphill of this triangle. Right.
And what else did we see? Woodland geranium.
There was some woodland geranium in there. Again, I think there might have been a little bit inside.
Yeah.
But I didn't have a definitive ID on it. I didn't include it in.
But
there was one of the geraniums.
Okay, woodland. Yeah.
But what you're saying is this is all irrelevant, because
it's an interesting study. But I'm already conceding your point, right?
Right. The point is that you don't have the supporting data from the hydric soil side.
Correct.
And therefore, this is irrelevant.
Correct. Okay. Because you need both.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are actually three lines. And it sounds like you're trying to get us to go back to the first line, which is uphill battle. When we first went there,
I could just intervene.
Okay.
because it's my lines at some basic level. We're happy with our proposal, which is to take the more conservative of the two sets of lines, but not encompassing the additional triangle that was added and that you asked to have delineated.
Okay.
That was our proposal at the last meeting, and you asked us to go back and have somebody go through the additional area that was added to decide whether or not that was included. We're willing to concede the more conservative set of the original lines.
Okay.
We just don't want to add the triangle that was.
That's what we're talking about, the triangle.
Mm-hmm. Right. You're talking about what?
The triangle. What we're discussing is the triangle.
Right, but yeah. You said that you were going back to Nicole's line, and we did not accept.
Well, I mean, I believe it's accurate, but if there was a concession to look at this
triangle's actually not on this
versus the quote the 40B line, right? Then if that was an agreement, then that's fine too. You know, I'm talking about the triangle in general.
Okay.
Okay.
Any concerns? I mean, it's a balancing test. It's not, and we've gone through this. I can't tell you, Scott, how many times we've gone through this.
Sure.
About whether or not it's one criteria or another criteria or a mix.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we generally come from the consensus mixture of, you know, totality of circumstances as to what is a wetland area. And I don't quarrel with your definition that there are other criteria to be considered.
Mm-hmm.
But I think we've got a dominant wetlands species.
Yeah, and we can break out the regs, and that's why they changed the regs in 95 to be specific.
I've been here since 93,
yeah. Yeah.
And we go through this probably every other month with a different wetland scientist.
I understand.
Some come in and say it's only soils, some come in and say it's only flora, and others come in and say it's both. And we've
some
heard them all.
Some come in and tell you it's three, right? It's hydrology, soils, and veg.
We've heard it all.
No, I understand. We can open up the regs and go through the regs if you want, but I'm pretty sound on this deal.
We've done that too, and we're pretty sound on it.
Yeah.
And my concern is that when you were going off in terms of Nicole's line, but the applicant has indicated that you're okay with the other more conservative.
Yeah, what we did, I mean, just to refresh the discussion from 3 weeks ago, there were two different lines done. There was the 40B line done, and there was Nicole's line done, and they have somewhat different boundaries, and we're happy to accept the more conservative blending of those two lines. In each place where there's a more conservative one, we're happy to take the more conservative one. The issue that was raised was the further area outside of both of those lines, which was defined by the burning bush, and which is what prompted us to ask Scott to return and go through that area and ask if that area, in addition, needed to be creating a new 100-foot line that goes well beyond these lines that we discussed here. And so we send him out to go through that area.
I agree, and I appreciate what you're saying. Actually, I think the way that it was described in the map that we got the last time, it was actually larger than we had indicated. I think it showed a line going from, I'm going to guess now, 15 to 4. And I think actually it was 15 to 6. It actually cut off. It was not as great as you just indicated. But I appreciate what you're saying.
So we're, with respect to the original lines, we're happy to take the more conservative set of the two original surveys. The question that you posed to us was to go back outside of those lines to the area of the burning bush, which creates an additional area, and ask what is that area? Should that additionally be considered as a wetland area? And so we asked Scott to go out and take that area, and if I can approach you, I don't know what documentation you have in front of you, but I have our documentation from the last visit that we had with you, and we could talk about that just so everyone's clear on the map.
Yeah, those we should have all of those.
Right, we should because look, you guys have a lot of things on the docket every month, and so I don't want there to be any confusion about it.
Right. So
if you got them, that'd be great.
I think
what we proposed last time, maybe Scott can.
What we're saying is where the 40B line comes above the Nicole line, we'll just take the more conservative of
there
the two lines.
There was additionally a burning bush sitting out here. And on your walk, you had added some markers that created an additional triangle here.
Correct.
And then if you swing a 100-foot line off of that, what you get is a line that looks like that. If you use the burning bush.
It wouldn't be that far because we went from, the only correction we had was from C15
sure.
over to, and the question last time was between like, was it 5?
I can do that. So those pink flags right about here. And so the question and the area of evaluation was this.
Correct.
That's right.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I did the data sheet on right there.
Right.
But what we're saying is
the 100-foot line would come out instead of there defining where the 100-foot line is. If you went all the way out to the burning bush that was sitting out here, it would take the 100-foot and you did a 100-foot line that
right.
comes
so instead,
off of that point, you'd cover a very substantial
okay.
amount
instead
of property.
Instead of coming to the pink flag, which okay. I don't think is correct, we will come up to where the what we're calling the 40B line
think,
is here, which is kind of like splitting the difference, as it were.
I think the thing that you might not be aware of is that the 100-foot is a jurisdictional line. It's not a no-build line.
Yeah,
the
no,
25-foot is the... So the 100-foot might... Oh, excuse me. The 100-foot line might, in the end, make no difference at all to you.
Agreed.
Okay.
Absolutely agree.
Okay.
I think the way we left this at our last meeting was you said, we did our walk, there's a species outside of what you've delineated
right.
that's a wetland species. We'd like you to hire somebody mm-hmm. to go and do an evaluation of the area defined by that burning bush.
Right.
And the two points back here on this line here, that created the triangle that Scott went out
right.
and evaluated in detail. And you can see all the counts here from that evaluation and the soil testing.
Right.
And his description of the condition. Because I mean, and you know, some people have said to me, look, don't even bother, make the whole thing the 100-foot line, take the whole property. But I think I appreciate your attitude, was we want to get it right here.
Right.
The goal is to get it right here, and then we'll be back with our proposal, you know, when it's time for that. So I get that, but I think the spirit of the last meeting was, hey, look, we're a data-driven organization.
Right.
Our goal is to get it right. And so why don't you send somebody out there to go give expert opinion? And so we've done that. And that's the purpose of the discussion tonight.
Right.
Here, if it's helpful.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Yes,
because
thank you.
Remember.
Yes, no, because you have so many matters in front of you at all times. I mean, there's
right.
no way to remember every
but I remember
last
the,
case.
I remember the sequence at our last meeting.
Well, the species was right. I mean, your comment was right, which is that there are wetland species in that area. The conclusion of the expert is that there's a dual criteria for wetland determination. And he, you know, Scott, I think, made it clear the way the regulations read in his mind is that you need the species and the soil, both criteria. You are absolutely right on the species, no question about it. But then the dual criteria, the soils by his determination, and please correct me if that's,
no, that's
not
fair,
correct.
Fair.
I understand,
okay.
And I don't disagree with what you just said. What I disagree with is that we have the discretion to consider, a mixture of criteria.
Sure.
And one doesn't, there's no black ball that puts in and says, you can't have it because it's not soils. I think you can have it if you've got it with another criteria. But I know you've added the hydrology from staining, and those are issues.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm looking for a consensus-driven organization here. So I'd like to hear from abutters or members of the public, anybody that has a comment or a question. Anybody? I know there are some folks from the neighborhood there.
It's a little bit of out of our expertise. We obviously care to, like you all, to do it right and do it well, but I think it's we leave it to you.
Yeah. Oh, would you like the mic?
No. Ms. Swenson, no, thank you very much. I can identify you for the... For the record,
I'm comfortable with the compromise. I think it is an art as well as a science, and eventually, how you evaluate this, as you say, it's not perfectly etched in stone, black and white. And I think not finding the hydric soil, both when we were there and in Scott's review, I think that's legitimate. And the fact that we saw both types of plants had us kind of scratching our heads that day, you know. So I think to look at what we're calling the 40B line, I'm happy to go along with that. I think it still preserves so much of that area that is wet, needs to be. There were so many mosquitoes that day, I just remember the threat down here.
Unfortunately, when I go there as well.
I'm comfortable accepting that line.
You have a view?
I, in terms of the flora, I defer to Judith, and I agree with what Judith just said in terms of being comfortable with the conservative interpretation of the two previous lines.
Okay.
And the information that we have in front of us concerning the dominance.
The dominance is wetland.
It is, dominance is wetland.
Okay. Arthur?
I'm comfortable with the conservative line. Proposed.
Okay. Okay.
And can we get into plans and it's not
yet? Yeah, and I will say
that, well, we should give you a cleaned up singular picture there with one line.
Yes,
you know, I should have come with them. We brought that last time, but I should have come again with the proposed conservative grouping of line, so we didn't have all these lines on. So we'll have that for you. Absolutely.
Okay, but I would like both plans, because I know, and I think I kept mine, but I believe I left them in my car. Because we received two drawings from Bob Hannigan. Mm-hmm. The one we received first was not the one we're looking for. And I asked for the second one. Yes. He said, oh, I've got that one too. And then he handed us the second one with the more conservative line on it.
Correct.
So I want both of those lines both of those plans.
But there's only going to be one that's going to be referenced in the ORAD, so that's the plan that really needs to be in the file, right? The
correct. But that, correct. But what we need to have, like, the historic plan so that we can see.
Understood.
Right.
Because you're right, there's going to be one plan with the most conservative blending both of the lines together.
Okay.
There were other modifications to the line besides just that, though. During the site work, wasn't there another modification that was done?
Well, that's
as well?
That's
so we're not ignoring the other modifications. We're just saying this is the large. Wasn't there another one that was a smaller? We actually absorbed a straight line. There was a whole inlet that we got rid of.
We did. Hang on a second.
I don't think it has any bearing.
It gets sucked up into the blending mode.
I believe it does.
It's sort of overlap, right?
Right, but we're not ignoring other modifications.
We're just not adding an additional layer, which was the burning bush, would have defined another further line.
Yes.
We're taking the two lines that have been officially demarcated, the 40B line and the line that came, not officially, but that have been demarcated in the past, and we're saying in each case, whichever is the more conservative set of points, we'll take that series of points. The discussion here was to then say, should we be adding an additional area defined by the burning bush, creating that further triangle, and please can we have Scott go out and do an analysis of that that additional area? And he's giving you his proposal.
So we owe you a cleaned up plan.
Yes,
the
for sure.
Yeah.
All right, and there was another change that needs to be incorporated, and it may be totally absorbed
I think
by the conservative,
subsumed into
but that's fine.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you have it and you know it's
Yeah,
time?
I do. The minutes here from our site walk here, Bob Hannigan agreed to present a new plan showing the area in controversy, which extends south from wetland flag 15 and then turns west to join wetland flag 4.
Right, that's what we just talked about.
Correct, but where did that one go?
It's over in your, oh no, oh, no, it's made its way.
So it's from 15 to, where is 4? That's 5, that's 4. 15 was there.
So mm-hmm. What was the other area then?
It's 4, which I think is right there.
Wasn't there another area though?
But there was, somebody came in and thought it was larger than that. And I said, no, it's actually smaller than that. But I think the triangle that you did, I think you're correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so we brought it back.
Yep.
And you might have even made it larger, because if that's 5, then that's probably 4. You may have gone down to 3, because that's 1, 2, 3. So I think you went down to 3, and I think, from my notes anyway.
So was there another area outside?
No, it was less than that. No, this was the other area. See this line here? This is where we were, and we said this needs to go straighter. So actually, see, if this is the 40B line, we actually said, no, this other line should be straighter.
There was an inlet that we got rid of.
Exactly, right here. We got rid of this inlet right there. That's what you're thinking about, John, I'm pretty mm-hmm. sure.
Right, so once you get the merge plan,
it sounds like we'll be fine.
Yeah, yeah. This is the other one, this little section right here.
Because
that's
at that
specifically
point, we're proposing to take the more conservative.
Right, which is
in every case, in any place where the line is here or here, we'll take the more conservative, we'll take the more conservative,
right.
We'll take the more
exactly.
conservative.
Exactly.
We'll take, you know, and,
so, so that,
and that's what
that,
defines essentially its outer line,
right.
Which will be the most conservative.
Case. Okay, good. Right. I think that's what you were thinking of, John.
No, I knew exactly what I was down here.
Okay.
The mistake that we actually talked about before is that they thought it went down to that.
I think
it only went to that.
Uh-huh.
Very small difference.
Uh-huh.
But that's what you're talking about. I was talking about down there.
Okay.
So are we able to close this meeting with that as a condition to the the ORAD that will get you that cleaned up plan?
I think
Absolutely.
You were ready to go. Any comments? Public, one more chance. All right, is there a motion to accept this? And because this is a abbreviated notice resource area delineation.
So moved.
Okay, second?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Done. That's, it's contingent upon you getting us the final
Absolutely.
Plan.
Absolutely. Right.
You took my pen.
I did. And you know what? I haven't started the chew on yet, so you're
okay,
safe.
Thanks very much. Have a good night. Thank
All
you
right.
very much.
Thank you. Okay, next
Thank
on
you
the,
very much.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Yep. Next on the agenda is a request for a certificate of compliance, 44 Cliff Road.
And there's pictures also.
Right.
No, that's what I do.
Oh, do you want to test it?
This is it.
Hey, good evening.
Hello.
Have a seat and introduce yourself, please.
I remember this. This was great what they were doing.
Hi, I'm Bridget Gaffney, the owner.
Okay. Hi. Welcome.
Hello. You did good. Really good.
Thank you.
Nice.
You saw
in the
my
process.
Kids, they're all enjoying the space
Much
quite a bit.
Much to go. Yeah. We'll start to fill in now. This is just this year you planted it? Last year?
In May we planted it.
Just in May. Wow. Yeah. Yeah, it looks good. You seeing birds or butterflies or?
Butterflies, birds, bees. In the spring, there were a lot of caterpillars.
Nice.
That looks pretty nice.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Where did you get your plants from?
Cavicchio in Sudbury.
Oh, I've heard of that.
I think
okay.
it's Cavicchio here.
Great. All right.
Thanks.
Caviocello, something like that.
Thank you.
There was some, there was a conversation when we were on site about taking down additional trees back into in the forest to try to, I'm just recalling, right? Because there was a line that we said, and then there were the additional trees that were back there were dead or dying, and there was concern about taking them down. Do you know if they took any of the trees?
The only one that they took down was the one that was the invasive. I forgot what
it was. It was a buckthorn that you were going to take down?
Yeah.
And then remove some invasive species. It's actually on the order.
Yeah. And then the only other one there was a dead thing, and it actually fell over.
Oh, it did fall over.
Yeah.
And you just left it? You just,
yeah.
Yeah.
It may have rolled down the hill a bit, but yeah.
It does look, they look really nice. Beautiful,
yeah, thank you.
And we have a letter here from Nielsen Landscape Design from Andrea Nielsen Morse. It says, Dear Kathy, to conservation agent, this notification is to inform the Conservation Commission that the project at 44 Cliff Road in Milton, as described by the Notice of Intent and Project Narrative dated 9/17/2014, has been completed as planned with no deviations. From Andrea Nielsen Morse.
That's good.
All right. Do we need to see it?
Nope.
Any questions, comments from abutters, members of the public?
Unless you want to invite us over for cocktails.
We have plenty of space.
Okay. No, I think it looks
all right.
Good.
Thank
so,
you.
Then is there a motion to issue the issue a certificate of compliance?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
Discussion? Discussion? All in favor? You're done.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Nice job. Right.
Yeah. It looks very nice.
Thank you very much.
Really good work.
Those should go in there. All right. Next on the agenda is partial request for certificate of compliance, Lot 3 Gun Hill Road. Continued hearing. Good evening, sir, and welcome.
How you doing? Jim DeSalle, DeSalle Burke and Associates. I think we were down to a last few things. I don't know. Did you get the pitches that Jimmy sent?
Yeah. I could not figure out the pictures.
I can't figure them out either.
Okay. Well, I have another few cents. So.
Thank you.
Sorry.
That's good.
Thanks, dude.
There were three pitches of two pieces of riprap that was installed. I guess there was a couple of areas that had failed. I wasn't out there at the sidewalk, but Jimmy mentioned that they had pulled out the erosion control, which was requested. They put the riprap in those two areas, and you can see them on the two different pitches, and removed what he's calling bullbriar, whatever the invasive weed was, they pulled it and cut.
Did they cut back the lawn? When I look at these pictures, it appears, though, when we were there, the drop-off was dramatic right at the edge of the lawn.
Mm-hmm.
And looking at this, it would appear to me that you've effectively cut the lawn back 3 or 4 feet in order to
put the riprap in, and then
and all the area between the riprap is now dirt.
And it's now they reloomed it.
They reloomed it.
I'm not
right.
sure if he's reseeded it.
But this isn't loam that was extending into the area of growth before. This
no.
is this is actually cut back into the lawn.
Yeah, the growth that you were talking about, that where he pulled out that briar, the bullbriar, is this area in here.
Okay.
And how much did you cut it back, the cat briar?
Looks like about 6 feet, but I mean you can see it's still in the. The woods there.
Oh, it's still all over
there.
It's awful. It's just awful.
And I mean, it's.
And let me say, the reason why it's so bad is because when you do construction like this and you increase the amount of runoff, that's why it's watering this whole area. And you're also exposing it to light that it wasn't exposed to before. So within the construction process, you are aggravating this condition of having these invasives. And so I think we have to recognize that and figure out how we deal with it, because this whole place.
So let's remove solution option.
I don't know what the solution option is, but I think we need to recognize that this construction work created that extreme condition. It was there to begin with,
right.
And it's 10 times worse than it was before.
Because of the light.
Because of the light in the water.
So should we be talking about total removal of that invasive on the site?
Yes, I think we should be, and replanting. That's what we should be doing ideally, because it's really bad in there, and it's only going to get worse. You can cut it back 6 feet, it's going to grow out 16 feet. because it's on the edge now. It's getting all this water running down. It's getting all that light.
Wasn't the water running down before? I mean, it's a pretty steep drop.
I know, but once you have a lawn, whereas you had other vegetation there, now you have much less pull-up. You know.
A well-watered lawn.
Quite well watered. That's
true. It was pretty deep.
I think they should go in there another 20 feet and take it all out and replant with natives.
The invasives.
Really? Take all those
getting rid of the invasives.
Well,
what's this here that we see?
It's mostly catbriar that we saw in there.
No, no. What's remaining? Because Jim just said they took out, going back to the higher vegetation, right?
Yep.
So that when you said it took out about 6 feet, you're talking about from the edge of the loam.
Where the lawn was.
Back in.
And again, I'm just gauging it from this picture. I didn't do it, and I wasn't off the sidewalk.
I understand that, but my question is, are you talking about clear-cutting this? Because it looks like this is something other than what they removed.
Yeah, and I don't know what's left,
yes.
John. I don't know what's left in there. Yeah.
Yeah, that looks okay. But I agree that what we saw before was pretty,
it
looked like the little shop on Main Street.
And you can see. I mean, how far are you going to go in? I mean,
down the bottom of the hill.
And you're going to be in the 25.
Well, exactly. But the other problem is that if you remove it, are you destabilizing the soil?
Slope.
The slope. So it is an invasive and it is grown in.
You're destabilizing all of this anyway.
I think
so
for me,
but this isn't this isn't.
You know,
this,
for that, and, you know.
For me, the question is making sure that there isn't re-encroachment into the area where removal occurred. You're going to have to take out
an
amazing
area. Yeah.
I don't know that I have the answer to that, but I know that there are treatments that are pursued that control these types of invasives. And maybe one of the things that we can do is investigate that.
I think we need to go back to this site, though, because this is one of, I think, the most extreme that we've seen. And I think when we think about allowing enormous clearing for houses and it's all